Hello and welcome back to another game of Worlds 2017. I'm Clayton Captain Flowers Reigns, and he may not have his own chroma, but I'm still excited to welcome Zach Rusty Pie to Worlds 2017. You're even better than Rusty Blitzcrank.
I mean, I'll take it. I'm also very much happy to be here. Thanks for having me, Captain Flowers, and I'm excited for our first duo cast together.
It's going to be a great time. The Drakes have attuned to their element and are ready to roar for our next matchup, Lion Gaming versus Gambit Esports. While Gambit Esports did deliver on the aggressive plays we expected, they attacked each problem like a head of Hydras, all with ferocious bites and plenty of malice, but minimal coherence to bring it all together.
Yeah, that's why the head of Hydras is an apt description of them basically here. Maybe there's too many people talking, but the fault for Gambit from what we have seen of them lies predominantly in the execution. You would have to say Edward is a standout player regarding that, but not just the execution. Their decision-making felt like the bigger problem above everything else, even there, on why are we doing this, and then executing poorly. They seem to have an idea, and instead of saying, is this idea good or bad, they're already doing it and then jumping about it after, yeah.
Makes things a little bit difficult sometimes. And for a team that's been so dominant in the CIS region, this is the first time they'll need to recover from a losing day and really put that mental fortitude to the test.
Yeah, and that's the big question here. The last time that they did lose, even in their local region, it was a best of five in the finals. They still end up winning the whole series. They only lost maps. And now we're in best of ones. The question does have to be brought about of, can they bounce back? Or will those heads of the Hydra that you allude them towards actually be able to just stay strong? Or will they be biting each other?
Well, if Gambit or the Hydra, Lion Gaming have been striking like a manticore. Even in their own losses against Team WE, this team has looked ferocious and of a single mind.
Lion have looked fantastic. Of course, I had to look up what a manticore was before we got here, but still it makes a lot of sense. And you know why? They have one head. That's what I learned from it. So
yes,
they are one unit.
One.
They look fantastic. That's absolutely true. Even against the Pool 1 team of WE, and their early game is the place that you look at when you say that. Because ultimately, their mid game, their macro, it was still the problem against Team WE. But their early game, their individual players' strength stands out to me the most. They were keeping up with the best.
Right. It looked good today. And one question people would have had coming from yesterday into this second round here today would have been, was Lion just having a good day? Is this actually for real? And they do look like they're for real. This does look like a team that is going to be one of the more threatening units from these areas that are not your Pool 1 teams.
And it wasn't just a one-off, exactly. So they're able to stay as a threat. And now you do look at that when they get to the best of fives, if they win this game,
right,
to secure themselves that position. You may not want to be playing against Lion if you had to choose.
This is one of the teams that I think has pleasantly surprised a lot of people so far. I'm looking forward to hopefully being pleasantly surprised by them more and more times as we continue. They definitely look like a team that should be fighting their way out of this initial group stage into the knockout stage coming up within the next couple of days. That being said, we cannot discount Gambit. Although they have their work cut out for them, there is still a distinct possibility that this team could make it into that knockout stage. It's just going to be some hard work.
Yeah, that's the thing. You know, we can compliment Lion all we'd like. We can call them this outstanding team so far, even though they've been getting the losses, but we do have to bring it back to Gambit because you can't discount them. You know they're an aggressive team, and they've had that whole day to go back now, talk to themselves, talk amongst each other, watch the VODs, what went wrong in day number one, and now there is that opportunity because this is the first game of the day we're seeing them to see if they have learnt overnight, if they've been able to bring back that strength and react accordingly between the days.
Honestly, it's such a short turnaround period too. I mean, we talk about, you look at previous worlds where teams sometimes have good performances in week number one of groups, and then week number two, things look a little bit shakier. You ask about the preparation between those two stages. This isn't week one and week two with preparation in between. This is day one and day two. You have such a small window to assess the problems, find out what went wrong, find out what was on point, and be able to make a more coherent plan going forward. It's a very tall task to actually rise to the occasion.
And you're right, that is vastly different to say the least. And what it means is you go backstage and you coach. I mean, it's not a fundamental shift. You don't have weeks to correct the fundamentals. It's the small details, it's the 1%. And that is something that Lion didn't have completely up to scratch in day number one, but they've been able to fix some of them. Still not getting the victories, but still fixing them as they go. And that might even make them more formidable coming into the Gambit game that we're about to watch. But Gambit, I mean, the little details still matter a lot for them. Sometimes it might just be reminding yourself that no is the option in this fight, that it's not always yes. Yet, I say that, and I'm apprehensive to say that because it is the CIS region and they love to say yes.
Right, that's their strategy. We like to see this team making those plays and making those roams and looking to set things up for themselves with a lot of initiation tools. And one way that we're looking to see that happen is especially through support player Edward, who was one of our players to watch at the kickoff of Worlds 2017 yesterday, but who just didn't put up the kinds of numbers and performances we were expecting.
Yeah, Edward was an interesting one for me, and the reason that he is someone that we have to bring up is because he was in our Team Mobile players to watch. You know, he was one of the five players that we hyped coming into the groups A and B, and he only had 40% kill participation. He only had one kill that he was able to pick up and three assists with seven deaths. That is abysmal as far as stats are concerned, and the reason that is important is because his AD carries kill participation was double. He was there in 80% of the kills. That basically just insinuates that Edward spent most of the team fights and skirmishes dead, which does indicate that he's being picked off, and we saw that through his gameplay. His Rakan engages, he was just flatly missing them.
Right, this is a guy who is known on those playmaker supports. This is a guy who earned his reputation on things like Thresh. This is the kind of guy that you want to see making those roams to different lanes, helping out the solo laners, helping out the jungler,
yeah,
moving in those smaller groups and succeeding in the skirmishes. And when he's not able to find that success, that doesn't bode well for the team as a whole and goes back to those problems that we were discussing where people seem like they're on different pages. We remember yesterday when they were on their back foot, when their opponents had just got Baron, they were trying to deal with a split pushing Jax, and instead of defending their own inhibitor, their mid laner goes bottom to try to collapse onto the Jax, and there's just multiple plans happening at the same time. But today is the day where they're going to have to shore up those weaknesses and truly flex their muscles here if they want to stand a chance moving on. Gambit Esports versus Lion Gaming into Champion Select now, as Kane and Anivia banned away by Lion. Gambit Esports responding with Maokai and Jace Ban.
And as we're into Champion Select, you have to remember that this is a must win for both of these teams. Gambit to get the tiebreaker against Lion Gaming, so it will effectively be two wins for Gambit if they get this one that is required for them to make it at all. Lion Gaming just need the one.
Varus going to be their third ban in this first Champion Select. Draft is going to be as important as ever for both of these two teams. That's one thing to remember whenever we go into these international tournaments like MSI and Worlds, is for a lot of these teams, they're playing up against picks and strategies and compositions that they're not normally used to going up against, and you've got to acclimate and adapt to those changes. Sejuani, the final ban for the first stage here by Gambit Esports.
And you know, while we're looking at these strategies, there's been vastly different strategies you take when going into Gambit Esports. Strategy number one is ban out the target champions, their specialty champions. Kane and Nivea are the two that stand out the most. WE didn't, they still won. Lion did, and they still won. So it's about how you adapt to getting rid of those pocket picks. You have to pick the strong meta champions yourselves, the best options yourself.
Speaking of strong meta options, it looks like Kalista will be the first pick here for Lion Gaming, a champion that we expected to see plenty of coming into the Worlds 2017 tournament. Now we're going to get to see her here.
Yeah, so we're looking at perhaps a Tristana on the other side of the rift when they get towards their AD carry, but they don't need to pick that one just yet, as they know the Kalista first pick is where it's going to be. So Gambit, they lock in the Alistar for themselves, and I quite like that, taking a part of a really good Kalista combo. But remember, Rakan still exists if they want to throw in some engage tools, if engage is their option.
Always possibilities there when Kalista can throw the teammate into the enemy team, get those melee fighters in there to cause disruption in the middle of the entire enemy squad. Gragas and Alistar together, plenty of disruption and melee tank ability on the side of Gambit Esports already, as Braum is locked in for Lion Gaming, so you will have some of that frontline capability, some disengage as well.
There's something that works quite nicely with auto attackers when you have the Braum, so normally you'll see the rest of the team composition start to pan out in exactly that way. Often you'll have the Lucians mid, but this also has quite a bit of auto attacking involved in the kit.
Absolutely. Jarvan picked up for Lion Gaming here. We've seen this guy be flexible top lane and jungle, has plenty of initiation power of his own, and is very, very scary in both doing the damage as he bursts you down and walking away from getting killed in retaliation. Now Gambit Esports thinking about who they want to take before the second rounds of the bans come in, and it looks like Cassiopeia is the one they're going to stick on.
Yeah, this is very curious from Gambit. They don't prioritize their AD carry whatsoever. Of course, there's still a lot available for them, but what they do get is the Cass. And the reason Cass is a standout picker alongside the Gragas and Alistar is that is a lot of protection, and Cass also provides a lot of magic damage. So now, when you look towards the AD carries that Gambit will be picking, hyper carries stand out. You've got the Tristana, potentially even the Twitch is someone that you may be looking towards for blasting here. Tristana's the number one, though.
Tristana could very well be banned away here. You do see Gambit Esports focusing on the mid lane bans, trying to alleviate some of the potential difficulty in that matchup for Kira's Cassiopeia. Orianna will be the first one they ban away. There's that Tristana ban from Lion Gaming. So they're seeing exactly what could cause trouble for this Kalista pick. getting rid of it.
Yeah, so the Tristana does make the most sense. Perhaps the second AD carry to follow if Lion are aware of what Blastling wants to play, but they may actually change it up and spice things up here. On the side of Gambit, getting rid of the Orianna, very good matchup for her into the Cassiopeia. So we're going to get rid of that off the board completely. Alongside other mid laners, it seems that they just want to empower Kira to have the best matchup that he possibly can after they've blind picked him in mid lane.
Well, I mean, this is a situation, like we were talking about, you need to win all these remaining games if you're Gambit Esports. Like, you have no time to wait around to flip the switch and actually turn everything on. It's time to go right now. And if the way you think you can do that is making sure your mid laner gets the best possible game he can play, then that is the strategy you have to go all in on. Shen will be that second ban from Lion Gaming here in the second phase, the last one to finish this champion select as we get into the last few picks, and Jhin, the AD carry for Gambit.
Yeah, that is very different from the side of Gambit. We're not going to have the Tristana as it was banned, but instead of going towards a Kog'Maw or a Twitch or another big hyper carry, even Jinx is a champion of option, they choose the Jhin, someone that you'd say can hyper carry, but not in the same way by any means. Just has a lot of damage and high burst, and the tanks that are there on the side of Lion Gaming are very equipped to deal with Blastling on his Jhin.
And we know how vulnerable Jhin can be if caught out of position as well. And when you've got things like a Galio and a Jarvan and even a Braum that are able to get on top of him and provide a lot of threat, provide a lot of disruption, it means Blasting's positioning is going to be paramount to success of Gambit Esports in this game. Both of those carries, no inbuilt mobility on the side of Gambit Esports. So you've really got to be looking out for those Jarvan Cataclysms, as Camille will be the final pick for Lion.
Yeah, we've got a Galio and we've got a Camille. So good matchup in the mid lane for Kira for the most part. We've seen Faker play the matchup a million times. I'm sure everyone studies him when they study Cassiopeia. But now you look towards the side of Gambit Gaming. The Camille pick, rather, from Lion is a takeaway from Steos, and it was also a Jax hover before that. So the question was always going to be, does he just pick the other one of the two split pushes so they can duel into each other? Because usually you'd like the Jax into Camille.
Now, yesterday, we got to see the Jax-Camille matchup firsthand. We got to see it not go very well for Gambit. We got to see the Camille of PvP Stayhost not work out very well compared to the Jax of Geralt. This time, they're going to be switched around. So this is always something that I personally enjoy seeing, Rusty.
Yeah.
Is when you get to see two players go head-to-head in a matchup, and then you just switch the champions and get to see them do the same matchup. If one person manages to win it both times, then you pretty much know this is simply the better player.
Yeah, to me it's almost like the statement game if you are able to
right.
win on both sides of the matchup. Even if one side's the losing matchup, in this case, Geralt is the one who has blind picked the Camille, knowing full well Jax is available and knowing full well how to play the Jax into the Camille. And so that's the real question that you'd have about this 1v1 is how well do they both know their respective champions and are they able to execute on those? And do they know both sides of the matchup?
And we know both of these champions, we got to see it yesterday as well, can be a serious threat if they do manage to get ahead. One of these finds a significant lead over the other when you end up in a situation where one's essentially on turret hugging duty the entire game, and the other has the freedom to split push and move around the jungle and apply that pressure as they see fit. Can make life very, very difficult for the other side to keep track of.
Of course, as we see these team compositions, the reason the top lane is so important is not just that 1v1 matchup against each other, but the fact that they're split pushes, which is a second win condition for both of these teams.
Heading into the Rift here for the fourth game of the day, Worlds 2017 Play-In Groups, day number two. Remember, at the end of today, Rusty, two of these teams are going home. For some teams at Worlds, right. Worlds started yesterday. It ends today for two of the teams. If you are not in the top two of your group at the end of your 2 days of group play, Worlds is over. It's such a rapid system compared to what we're normally used to seeing that for a lot of people watching this, it's like, wait a second. Are you sure they're going home already? I'm not sure. Don't you have a second week of this? And the answer is no. This is where they have to show up. This is where you have got to prove that you are worthy to continue playing, that you deserve a chance at the knockout best of five. And that is what Gambit Esports has to do now.
All of the preparation, all of the time and planning that you spend absolutely does just wash away very quickly if you go without a victory. And for Gambit, they need to get that one, put themselves into the tiebreak position up against Lion, who have looked fantastic. You would have to say, until this game plays out, undisputed the second best team in this group, and it's on Gambit to prove them otherwise.
Lion, definitely surprising a lot of people so far. White Lotus and Seiya, especially having very, very convincing performances on these carry champions. Great KDAs by these guys, great performances in general.
And we are seeing something different through the middle lane, actually, as we're looking at Kira against Seiya. One thing that I have to discuss about this is the Mana Crystal start. And like, maybe not the most uncommon thing you'll ever see in Summoner's Rift, but it's not a Doran's Ring to win mid lane. It's not a Darksteel to have potion efficiency with your refillable potion there. It's to early recall. And usually you'll be looking at like the 18, 17 CS mark on the third wave with the cannon minion. Once you get to that wave, if you're able to clear successfully in recall, then you'll have the tier. And that's about stacking up the tier earlier and being stronger when you hit mid-game. So that's the conscious decision that Kira has gone towards here, which to me indicates the jungler has to be a bit more passive if you're Diamond Procs. And I mean, is Diamond Procs, is that a thing?
Is that really going to be the game plan that you expect Gambit Esports to go for, right? Do you expect this team, known for their aggressive movements and their roaming and their playmaking, to play passively? And maybe it is. Maybe this is how they're going to change things up and potentially try to get themselves on the board here in day number two. But they will have to go through Lion to do it. And right now, Audi moving up into Diamond Prox's territory. He did just go buff to buff and immediately look to invade.
Yeah, Diamond doesn't have to be aggressive if Audi is going to be the aggressor, of course. He looked fantastic playing against WE, but that was when Kondi was going towards him. He returned the favor nicely, and so Audi is going to try his hand here at this camp.
Audi will successfully steal away one mini chicken. Now he gets two. Cass gonna be down on the ground. Diamond Prox gets three of the small ones, but Audi takes the big monster away from the camp and wins out in the trade.
Yeah, gives him the Thunderlord's proc as well, and he's still got the red buff in advantage for himself, where Diamond Prox does not have that there. So Gambit Esports jungler not gonna have the best experience around the red buff that he's looking towards himself. Audi has control, but you have to look towards the rest of the map. This 1v1 can go on forever. If Jiral or Steos come over, if Kira or Seiya actually make it in, things could change.
Steos trying to go for a little bit of a trade there. Jiral jumping in, getting himself the heal with the Camille W. Also getting that nice kick there on the back end of it to make sure he wins out on the trade. But this is one of the most annoying situations to be in as a jungler, when the enemy jungler is stronger than you and just sits in your jungle and your team cannot help you.
This is like modern Pudge Wars.
Flashback, but Diamond Prox now potentially in a lot of trouble here. Flashes over the wall, gets himself within his turret range and stays safe, but Audi will continue just hanging out in the enemy jungle. Steos moving himself over. Might look for a way to do something here. Drops the Counter-Strike, gets himself away, hops over the wall to the Krugs. Stay safe.
I mean, he'll get out fine, but he also has no health because he's losing the top lane. Audi still has complete control in the jungle, and by the time the Jax got here, Gragas had already flashed away. So ultimately, Gambit way too slow to the punch. Sometimes you just have to sacrifice your own lane to help your jungler and hope that the reciprocity is there, and then he'll come back and help you. But neither of those things happen. In fact, the J4 may have an opportunity to do some damage here to the Jax.
Let's see if Audi can make this gank work out. Hookshot comes out, not gonna be finding the stun just yet. Counter-Strike coming out here as Steos gets himself away. Audi's gank, not incredibly effective, but at least he did get that red buff before he leaves enemy territory.
Yeah, really well played in the game of chicken there from Steos to be able to not have to use his flash, not have to jump to safety, just Counter-Strike and bait spells out of them. They don't choose to flag drag either, so Audi will just back it up. He's got his red buff. He's a pretty happy camper as far as he's concerned. And now he gets to go back and clear a majority of his own jungle that is always going to still be there when you spend most of the early game in Diamond's jungle.
Taking a look at the farm across the board, you can see a little bit of a lead for Lion there in the bottom lane. A little bit bigger of a lead for Gambit in mid lane and top, pretty much breaking even. Seiya going aggressive here in a trade onto Kira. Talked about Kira starting with that mana crystal, sacrificing some early game power. Seiya taking advantage of that for now as Diamond Prox shows up mid, but he doesn't accomplish a whole lot of anything.
Yeah, still almost equalizing. It feels like by not recalling, Kira's going to go towards the Catalyst build. So he should be going towards the Abyssal Mask build, presumably. May do Rod of Ages, however, as Jarvan is not a magic damage dealer. And so it might be more efficient to have that AP as Seiya still going.
Diamond Prox just cannot catch a break. He gets invaded time and time again. Tries to walk over and smite the big chicken, but it has lost its patience and will not be taken just yet.
Seiya's is coming down, though. He might have the jump.
Steos jumping in, Counter-Strike active, really threatening onto Audi here, who needs to find a way to get away from this one. No longer has his flash available. Steos trying to jump in there, might be able to find the first blood, and it goes over to Diamond. That is righteous justice for having spent so much time with his opponent in his jungle. Now he gets his revenge.
Absolutely, so the Jax finally comes back down. Audi does not have his flash throughout all of this. The Jax does, and he flashes very aggressively past the Jarvan to ensure there's no taunt that's gonna connect, and actually redirects him in range of the body slam. So Diamond does get his red buff back after all, and that sweet justice you mentioned is going to be had by Gambit Esports.
For all the work that Lion Gaming put into setting the Gambit jungler behind, it's all undone with that first blood going over to Gambit. Assist money also going to be on to Stayhouse there, so he makes up for some of the money that he would have sacrificed losing the farm, making that roam down towards mid. And honestly, they couldn't have asked for that to go much better.
Absolutely. But you know what, Captain Flowers? I'm a little bit confused with this middle lane once again. Just the items. He still went for the tier, and instead of recalling early, starting Matter Crystal, he chooses to go towards the tier and just recall later. So now he's going to delay his tier timing, and he's still going to go towards the Catalyst afterwards, which is fine and expected. Edward actually up in the top lane as well, doing his standard. This looks like very much a more well-rounded and normal Gambit.
Yeah, this is what we expected to see from this team. Those super early level, well, pre-level 6, I should say, support roams before anything really else happens. But he can't quite find the angle he's looking for, so not going to find that payoff just yet. Stayhouse looking pretty comfortable in this matchup, 1v1 topside now on the Jax. Even though the Camille has better itemization through the Phage, he's really not worried about it. But now, Geral with more health, more mana,
to this.
Might be able to win this fight. Issues the Hextech ultimatum, the Galio coming in, and it might just be an outplay. Nope! See you later, Geral grabbing the kill.
And the outplay is the damage reduction as well that the Galio ultimate's going to provide to Geral. So they get the kill, you call it the 1v1, but I can still see an assist down there for Sayer. He's going to be able to pick that one up, go back towards the middle lane, and that's big for the Camille. This is a stark contrast to what we saw the last time these two champions faced off against each other. And quite simply, it's just about being that little bit stronger, ultimately from the damage reduction. One auto attack is what separated them.
I mean, if you didn't have that damage reduction coming in there, Stayhouse outplayed the heal from the Camille. He got inside of the inner part of the cone
first. Reduced it.
He would have managed to win that, but woulda, coulda, shoulda, who knows, it didn't happen. And thanks to the Galio, thanks to the presence of mind from his mid laner, Geral now has an extra edge in that 1v1.
And once again, last time they played against each other, Geral was the Jax and he was winning the matchup. So perhaps it is the player more than anything else, Captain Flowers. Perhaps it is. Still to be seen, of course. They're both split pushers. They're both scalers. Jax will have that really big spike with the Sheen moving forwards.
One thing I also want to keep an eye on as we move forward, closer and closer towards the 10-minute mark, closer and closer towards mid-game, rolling around a few minutes after, is Infernal Drake is the first one spawning this game, which means teams may be more apt to fight for that than they would from other ones if you had something like a Cloud Drake or potentially even an Ocean or Earth Drake. Teams always want these Infernals. They always want to get those damage bonuses, especially when you have these carry-style top laners like the Jax, like the Camille. You get so much value out of it. I would expect to see a fight for that sooner than later, but if a fight does break out on that end of the map, you do have an advantage on the side of Gambit Esports considering they have TP available there for the top lane.
Expertly traded to an extent from Stayhouse just there as well in the top lane, and to bring it back, as they are going to fight for this blue buff a little bit first, Drake is a place they could look towards, but this seems to be like the higher immediate priority and the safer priority that they can look towards. Gambit want this blue buff.
Let's see if Seiya and Adi can defend here. Blue buff down below 1,000 HP. Taunt coming out from Seiya. Counter-strike on Stayhouse, keeping himself alive. Geral trying to jump in there with the hook shot. Diamond Prox potentially going to be caught out here.
Oh,
trying
no.
to flash over the wall. Doesn't find his way out just yet, but Geral going to be the one almost going down. Seiya grabbing the kill onto Diamond as Geral falls as well. One for one so far. Gambit walking themselves out.
It's actually just going to reside as a one-for-one trade, but it's the jungler of Gambit Esports compared to the top laner of Lion that is going to go down. Jax will get a bit of extra time farming, but still with a Cassiopeia, with a Jax there, I don't think they want to do the Infernal Drake just because of the risk of the smite, and so it's a full reset. Unfortunately, I mean, they might have lost the one person they didn't want to lose when it came to fighting for this blue buff. Of course, we get to see this again. The thing I want to highlight is Kira has to flash early here, and Stayhouse is never going to get a chance to use that due to the taunt from Seiya, preventing all of the damage. And at this point, like, wow, pretty good moment here for Lion, but three-man body slam, even after the mistaken flash from Diamond Prox, is enough to be able to create a trade. So ultimately, the mistake, almost a blessing.
Yeah, the flash was really unfortunate there, yeah. But it ultimately worked out okay at the end of the day. Granted, Gambit was not able to steal the blue buff away. Want to go ahead and comment on that one as well. You did see that go over to Seiya. So the initial mission failed, but everything worked out sort of all right. One for one, not the most convincing of victories, but definitely not a loss either. 400 gold, the lead now for Gambit Esports over their counterparts in Lion Gaming. And Honestly, Gambit's doing a lot better than people might have expected them to do based on their performance yesterday. They did not look convincing in either one of their games. Today, they're coming out swinging against Lion. They're making the kind of plays we would expect from this team, and it just looks like they feel more comfortable.
Yeah, we saw it for 5 minutes in their second game, and it looks like maybe they've just continued to warm up that little bit more every single time they've played on Summoner's Rift. They're rotating, absolutely right. They are able to get Edward to the top lane. They're able to get the Jax now coming down, and he's even looking towards an opportunity in the mid lane.
Whoop! Tries to jump in, but a good dodge away with a Justice Punch from Seiya will keep him nice and safe. The two members there, Steos and Kira, the members of Albus Nox that impressed us so much in 2016 Worlds, now on this Gambit Esports squad in 2017, hoping to make the same type of a run that they did last time around, but having a little bit more trouble out the gate compared to then.
A much longer way to go this time when you want to talk about that run. They need to try and get this victory, get another victory over Lion later in the day, and then win a best of five against one of the other teams competing, presumably from pool one. So, look, that journey's going to be a little bit more difficult
it
for them
a long
so
journey.
Far, and it's long.
But Lion now starting off the Infernal Drake, like we mentioned a couple of minutes ago.
I mean, Gambit are looking at this. There's definitely an opportunity for them to fight for it if they choose.
Steos has his teleport available. They can try to force a fight on this if they want to, but Lion will go ahead and secure it for themselves. The early smite into the Rin from Kalista means Infernal goes their way.
I think the big scare is that Jiral was down there just so early. They choose to get Steos the extra farm, extra experience in the top lane, and perhaps force this teleport. Ultimately, whilst the teleport being forced is not bad timing for Lion, there's still a moment and, you know, a window of opportunity for Gambit to make a play adverse on the other side of the rift if they choose, just by being able to unlock their Jax.
Want to go ahead and comment on the same thing that we saw yesterday? Jiral versus Steos. Not the Trinity Force versus Trinity Force rush on both of these. We are seeing the Ninja Tabby on Steos first. Curtain Call opens up bottom lane, not to accomplish much of anything, quite
honestly.
No, he
was trying to clear the wave, but Braum exists.
And now Steos interrupting the hookshot from Jiral, trying to keep him here long enough for Diamond Prox to show up and make this gank happen. Diamond wanting to get in there. Nice cask!
From downtown, so they lock it down. Jiral's gonna die, and instead of using their teleporting member to go to the rest of the map, they bring Diamond Prox up to him, just knowing that Steos is able to win that 1v1 of his own accord, and suddenly the tower looks like a possibility, but thankfully Seiya exists to prevent it.
Seiya shows up, not in time to save his ally, but in time to save the turret, and considering Lion has put so much damage onto the bottom lane tier 1 of Gambit Esports, this might be pretty important as it could potentially buy them the opportunity to find the first turret and the gold bonus that comes with it.
You'd have to worry if you're Lion here, not just because of the turret, but because the Jax has brought it back. Camille got the early kills, but things have shifted. The times are changing. And that Jax can outscale Camille very quickly, especially at that Trinity Force spike. Especially at the level 6 spike, where you don't have to commit an ultimate to trading against your opponent. It's just 3 auto attacks.
Kira slithering his way down towards the bottom lane. Gambit Esports trying to mount an attack on this bottom lane tier 1 as they push the wave up, but realizing there's not really any sort of plays to be made, they're going to go ahead and send the jungler and mid laner back up towards the river. Just let that bot lane continue to push on its own. They still only have a 500 gold lead. Honestly, Rusty, if we're looking at the comparison between the economies of these two teams, it's a very close game.
Yeah, it certainly is. There's a very big concern as well if you are Gambit, even with the 500 gold lead of the Kalista coming to the rest of the map. Right now, Braum and Kalista actually coming up towards top lane, trying to perhaps influence once again where that teleporting member of the team is to prevent any kind of number disadvantages if they sneak in.
An immediate follow-up from Gambit Esports bottom lane as well as they move themselves up to the top lane, recognizing, hey, Lion's probably going to trade these off. We're going to do the same. Let's not be caught off guard by this.
Yeah.
And so we're just going to see a little bit of Australia lanes.
Yeah.
Because you're Australian. And now this gets to make sense. Because we're doing the Australian and not Australian co-cast. We're just like the top lanes.
Thank you very much. They're engaging.
Now we've got the engage, the stun. Kira trying to get himself away, but the team collapses and manages to find themselves the damage. White Lotus grabbing the kill credit on that one.
I think Gambit just snuck away the Herald throughout all of this, though, at the same time from under the noses of Lion as they engaged onto Kira. I mean, they'll take that trade. It's actually pretty good, but they are pushing mid lane at the same time.
Lion trying to get something back in exchange for that Rift Herald there, seeing if they can manage to grab themselves this objective. They already grabbed the kill onto the enemy mid laner. They don't quite have the damage to make the turret happen. Curtain Call opens up. Gentech's going to be tanking all those shots. They really don't do a lot if you have high HP, especially against a tankier target like that Braum, until the Jhin has more damage under his belt.
Yeah.
So he'll just walk himself away from that one. Gambit will hold the line at the turret.
Yeah, and they're able to do that. Of course, even the fourth shot from Jhin was used just to clear the wave. He knows he's not doing all that much damage himself. Hasn't completed the Infinity Edge, so not all that impactful. However, throughout all of this, whilst they only got damage on the mid lane turret, it's still good damage. They get the first turret in the bottom lane. The top lane's the place that they can look towards and send their duo, which has been controlling the 2v2. So ultimately, Lion, I'd say still in the driver's seat as far as the towers are concerned. It's just that we are seeing some fight in the Gambit system. They do have what it takes to keep up.
Which is a lot of fun to see. This is what fans wanted to see from this team. For a lot of people, they were excited to see Gambit make their return to the world stage here in 2017. The last time we got to see this team at Worlds was 2012, 5 years ago.
Long time ago.
Many people hyped up, not just for the fact that this team has two Albus Nox Luna members, like we already talked about their impressive performance from 2016, but if you look at Diamond Prox and Edward, two of the old guard names from Moscow 5, one of the original teams that showed us what competitive League of Legends could look like way back in the heyday. So for many, many fans, old and new, there's expectations for this team. They want to see them succeed. They want to have fun cheering for Gambit Esports. And right now, Gambit's giving them something to cheer.
It's always an interesting conversation to have as well. You know, is that hype unjustifiably high just because the last time you saw them was Moscow 5 and they were just that good of a team?
Yeah.
But, you know, that's kind of fair to have those expectations because that's just what you want to see. And, you know, the fact that they do have some fight in their system is a pleasure to start to watch and to see the improvement from game one to now. It's still there and it's still a marked improvement.
I mean, for so many fans, it's just the fact that even if there isn't a logical reason to expect this team to be the same team that they were in 2012, there's still that same sort of excitement that you feel when you watch the team in 2012, when you watch these guys introduce us to what counter jungling looked like with the unorthodox Shyvana picks and three buffing the enemy team. They want to see those same kind of moves. And now it's Steos. Might potentially
be
one versus two here. They go in, issue the Hextech ultimatum. Geralt looking to find the damage, but Diamond Prox manages to make this an even fight after all. Trying to go in back here onto Geralt. Asaeus shows up. Now it's going to be three versus two. Diamond Prox finding himself in a spot where he's almost not able to escape.
Ooh.
Flash into the taunt is able to lock them both down, and Steos flashing over the wall, barely staying alive until double kill comes in from Geralt.
Geralt comes up clutch a couple of times. They're hitting these hookshots. Seiya makes it an unfair fight in the first place just by being that Galio. He's able to rotate extremely quickly, and we're seeing no impact from Kira if we're going to contrast these mid laners. Whilst the advantage was there for Steos, how quickly things start to shift in the other direction just because of the numbers game that Lion are winning.
Lion grabbing themselves another Drake. They're also going to grab themselves another turret. They will lose the one topside, so Gambit grabbing that means they're going to have a little bit of extra global money, but let's take a look at the play.
And first thought is that this was a good ultimate from Diamond Prox. Separates the two players, but Steos is well and truly out, and Diamond Prox is now completely stuck. Seiya, very much aware of the flash being up and available, has one of his own, and is even able to find the Jax through that. So incredibly well played and smartly played from the mid laner of Lion.
I always forget how far the distance of Camille's hookshot is until you see it in action. You're like, oh wait, she can close that level of distance.
The fact you can flash after it as well.
Yeah,
the amount of distance it covers.
It's pretty dirty sometimes, and Geralt manages to get himself his third kill off the back of it. But now Shelly charging into the tier one turret here in the mid lane against Lion. Gambit trying to grab themselves the second turret, see if maybe they can even that count up. Edward gonna be soaking some damage from those turret shots. But they do get what they came for, and the game is still within 500 gold rust. Neither one of these teams is pulling that far ahead. It's just blow for blow, back and forth.
And that one trade just there from Gambit is the reason that it is so close, because ultimately after the kills that happened in the bottom lane, there was a trade up from the side of Lion. They get a turret and they get the Drake, where it was just one turret in the top lane that the Jhin was able to secure meanwhile on the rest of the map. So the fact they get the mid lane turret, everything equalizes, and it feels like we are still in a game that's closer than it ultimately should be based off what I've been seeing from Lion so far.
And we've talked a lot about the Jax versus Camille and the snowball and the split push and this kind of 1v1 super duel between the top laners, and checking in on sort of the status of that as we go forward. You can see a lot more farm on the Jax, but just a better KDA on the Camille overall. The gold between the two, a couple hundred gold better for the Jax, but that's about it. This isn't one of those runaway situations. These two are still very evenly matched.
That was a really nice play from Geralt.
definitely evading that Counter-Strike and immediately delivering the Justice a killing spree, flashing the emote, letting him know he came to the wrong neighborhood.
Oh, and he's feeling himself now. Jirall's able to get that 1v1. Say, I should say a little bit too deep, to be fair, from the Jax. Not too sure where he was going for that dive, but now the pressure continues through this top lane 1v1. Not just the KDA starts to go in favor of this Kool now. It's a little bit more.
You always got to respect the ability that Camille has to have that brief iframe as she goes into the air for the ultimate, dodging away from the stun. And now, they're looking to make the dive here onto Diamond Prox in the bottom lane. Cass going to get himself away for now. But Genthix and Jirall now have the opportunity to lay more damage into this tier 2 turret. Another Q thrown out by the Gragas to clear the minions away, keep that turret alive. But it's Lion with control over the bottom part of the jungle of Gambit Esports.
Yeah, and the ultimate did double the work there for Diamond Prox, helps clear the minion wave as well as save himself. So he'll get out okay. The turret will get out relatively unscathed considering, but even taking the turret, tanking it just to get that extra bit of damage down, Jirall, knowing what the champion he is, does on Camille. Very well done from the side of Lion, and they're starting to creep a little bit further ahead every single time. It's these really small details, but it's no longer 500 gold.
Right, we're up to over 1,000 gold now. Items starting to come online for multiple members. You've got the Cinderhulk, Knight's Vow, very standard tanky supportive style jungle build coming out for Audi's Jarvan. You've got Adaptive Helm and Randuin's both completed for Seiya, very strong now on the front line. Jirall working on that Titanic Hydra to go along with his Trinity Force. So these members on this team, even the Blade of the Ruined King and Runan's Hurricane for White Lotus's Kalista, everybody's starting to get to the point where this team could be very scary, given the right situation.
Oh, they're going again.
Tech ultimatum a little bit early that time. Won't dodge away from the stun, but he's got Seiya here to make sure this is still not going to be a fair fight. Nice interrupt there using the Justice Punch.
Oh, no!
Counter-Strike! Jirall jumps a little bit too far backwards, but the Flash makes sure he gets the kill anyway.
Sorry, no one saw anything. He's still there. Jax dies in the end. They're able to push bottom lane. They've got a minion wave coming. If you're Jirall, you just keep going. That's at least one free turret to be seen for yourself. Galio can go back towards the mid lane. Baron's the only concern, the only threat, but they've already got Vision there. They're completely set up to defend it.
Honestly, Lion has been getting so much value out of these Galio ultimates this game. Flash away by blasting to survive the attack from Genthix and White Lotus. They're utilizing the Kalista ulti offensively. Seiya now back in the mid lane. Jirall still split pushing bottom, like you said, and we've still got 10 seconds before PvP's back up.
Yeah, and suddenly the 1-4 Jax is becoming the problem for Gambit Esports. Where do they go from here? Because ultimately against the Camille, there's no such thing as just scaling up, becoming a split pusher. He's already doing that better than you are. You need to actually look towards starting the group, perhaps get the team fight going. The Counter-Strike is a game changer if you're able to hit the correct targets, but you'll need those teleports, you'll need those flanks, and I mean, that's another feat entirely. I've always commended the vision control of Lion when they really want the objectives.
A lot of Gambit Esports members hanging around the mid lane right now, but they've already taken the turret. There's not really a lot they can do there, so quickly going to be forced backwards, having to regroup now. 2,500 gold behind their opponents. Next Drake spawns here in a minute. Baron is live. We are 24 minutes into the game, so that's always a possibility if a fight goes heavily one way or the other. But Lion continue to, like you mentioned a few minutes ago, appear as if they're in the driver's seat despite how close the game has been, simply because they're showing how good of a team they are.
Yeah, and if nothing else, it's just the momentum, basically, right, that is going towards them. And that momentum is enough to sneak objectives, to get towers, to get solo kills, just because the enemy team, in this case Gambit, doesn't know where the opposing team's going to be. They've just got one bit too many pieces of control around the rift, wards that are starting to go down. You can see them on the minimap in the river, starting to control majority of that area.
We'll have to see how Gambit can try to find a way to get themselves into a power position this game. They've been slightly behind for a lot of the game. They have been able to make some plays.
That's a green highway towards the top lane where Seiya is going to go for himself. So once again, Vision gives a turret. Gambit now try to trade. And we're in this really weird back and forth for them where the pressure's on for our red side.
Blasting 0-0 and 0 on the Jhin. Edwards, Alistair 0-0 and 0. We talked about the KDA for Edward not being up to where a lot of people were hoping it was going to be on day number one. But I guess 0 is still an okay KDA. I mean, it's not
negative.
It's not negative. It's not bad. It's just 0.
He hasn't committed
any big errors yet, but he also hasn't been around to make any sorts of big plays. We saw a couple roam attempts that never really came into their own, so
he's cosplaying WE's support.
Yeah, still waiting on him to find that opportunity and find that angle as Gambit does get themselves their first elemental Drake of the game.
Yeah, but at 25 minutes, you know, the oceans, it's nice to have. You've got a Cassiopeia with a mana pool. Gin always needs the mana, isn't going towards the Essence Reaver build, so you'll take it. But at the same time, what did you sacrifice for that? And it's extra control. The one bush they had for themselves in the river on the top side of the rift is removed, and Seiya starts the pressure.
Seiya with the taunt, flashing forward to make sure he's able to find Blasting, tries to get the Justice Punch, only lands it onto Edward, as now they're looking to make even more happen. Jarral coming over the wall, putting the damage onto Diamond. Hextech Ultimatum now issued, knocked backwards with the cast. Very nice placement on that one. Now Seiya coming in with a heroic entrance. Edward's still going to be finding multiple people with the Pulverize. He's the first one to go down. Jarral still barely going to be kept alive by the Camille passive. Genthix walking away from the turret. So much damage. The double kill for White Lotus. Make that one a triple, blasting the last man up, and he will not be for long. The last kill goes over to Seiya, and the clean ace for Lion Gain.
And clean's the name of the game here. All five people alive. Lion will just take the turret, look towards the Baron. Anything they want on Summoner's Rift is theirs, because they just outplay and out-execute their opponents in this game. So clean.
That looked like it could have gone so many different ways, and it goes the best possible way that it could have for Lion. Now they're moving on to the Baron. Now they've got the opportunity to take this objective while still having Jarral in position for the split pushing. This has gone from close to very much not for Gambit Esports.
And the craziest part about all of this is the engage looked a bit off from Jarral. He thought, why is he going this far forwards onto a Gragas by himself? Of course, Seiya is the one who kicks it off with the early flash, but Seiya is also the person you look towards, not just for that flash, but to follow up Jarral on his engage. This looks silly. But then suddenly silly is the best idea, because Gragas' ultimate throws him into the middle of three of them. They're all knocked up. White Lotus free hitting the entire time. And if White Lotus is able to free hit, there is no way the Gambit are going to be able to win this team fight. Kirit does not have the ultimate there to stop him. That was pretty much the moment it was over. And note, Seiya, he is tanking the turret, even though you can barely see his health bar moving.
Yeah, we talked about the tankiness of that Galio, and we were talking about the items everybody has. It's real hard to hurt this guy. 5,761 damage from White Lotus's Kalista in that team fight. Closest person to do that on Gambit is 2,332 from Blasting. There's just no comparison.
Not at all. Lion Gaming now with the Baron buff as well after that team fight. They did get the top lane in a turret through all of this. Momentum well and truly theirs. Gambit within the confines of their base predominantly from this point onwards. Desperate engage, perhaps the last option. They're the kind of team that will desperate engage, though.
And that's what you've got to look for. This isn't a team that's simply going to cross their fingers and hope their opponents make some sort of a mistake. You look at Gambit Esports, you're looking at a team that will try to make some sort of a desperation play, maybe make it happen, make some sort of awesome pick.
And the desperation play comes from removing Jax from the bottom lane. You can't actually use him to 1v1 Camille anymore. In fact, you can't really send anyone there. But it's too late almost. They have to send him down here. Jarrell's already pressuring, and this gives the opportunity for things to shift.
Steos goes in, manages to interrupt the hook shot. Now Edward gonna be showing up to make sure this fight is not fair, but Seiya will find yet another awesome heroic entrance to buy his ally some time. Now he's gonna be tanking three, four different people, but Gargoyle's Stoneplate means he just does not care, Rusty.
He actually didn't lose health, and there was three people there. In fact, he gained it through the Stoneplate. Lion now threatening two places at once.
Lion will take down that bottom lane tier three. Now they've got their eyes set on inhibitors. The rest of the team can rotate over if they like. They can continue split pushing with pressure on mid either. Also, I should say, but so many different options for this team at this point in time. You're 10,000 gold up, 30 minutes into the game. You've still got the Baron buff for another 90 seconds. Gambit just have no way to really deal with these guys. The game seems completely out of their control.
Yeah, we saw one point of hesitation from Lion. The recall, it's smart, it's safe. They'll be able to do this successfully. They'll still get a bit of extra push with the Baron buff in their pockets, but once they push bottom, once Jarral tried to take on Steos in the 1v1, the fact that it was mid and bottom that they were pushing means it's 2 seconds, and then suddenly the whole team of Gambit can pivot there. So they have to back away, they have to respect. Instead of setting up the lane assignments to be top and bottom, which is further away, harder for them to rotate between, they choose mid lane. And you have to wonder if that's because of the Galio, but at level 16, his ultimate range covers that far.
A little bit disorganized with the emote flashing there too. You see Seiya flash his Genthix is like, oh, I can do that too. You gotta flash them all at the exact same time to really show off that team synergy, but
it's important, man. You gotta get that going.
They're probably, I'm just going to bet that they're saving it for the Nexus. Flash them all five at the same time as you take down the enemy Nexus. That's how you make it look clean. But now, Audi and the rest of Lions seeing if they're able to catch out Diamond Prox here, putting a lot of damage onto him. Jarrell wanting to jump in, but the flash away from the Gragas will keep him alive.
He uses the flash, but he also uses the ultimate throughout all of this, and that's two big cooldowns start to go missing as now they continue to pressure Lion through their bottom lane in the top laners fighting each other.
Edward finding a little bit of damage onto Audi, and I mean a very little bit right there. Jarrell now going to be drawing the aggro.
Here we go again.
People, here comes the heroic entrance. Steos, the one who's going to be burst down very, very rapidly. The Cataclysm coming in, nearly going to be taking him down at the start of the fight. Audi limping away from this fight as Edward now going to be chased down by the rest of Lion Gaming. They're on to the back line of Gaming Esports. Kira's caught out, stunned up, brought down. And Edward tries to get himself out while covering for his team. Lion has found their way onto the inhibitor. They're still fighting Gambit in the back lines as well. It's a one-kill fight, but it goes the way of Lion. They get the inhibitor on top of it, and they walk everyone out.
And they still get the structures. I swear Sayer is just getting back scratches from the opponent's side of Gambit Esports here. And I thought they had weapons. Evidently not. They're not able to do enough damage, not able to pick apart the tanks, and suddenly they're able to walk it out and get an Infernal Drake for their troubles on the back end of that, as if they needed that as well.
Jax has quotes about maybe if he used a real weapon. It's about time to find one now, because the damage just isn't there.
Yeah, definitely not. Of course, we get to watch this again, and majority of it, you won't really notice what Seiya has done in terms of impact. This was a big taunt from him, however, able to keep the fight going for them, secure the first kill on Nakira, but he's still there. How are you going to get through him when he just stands in front of you? No one's going to be able to defend that inhibitor.
All right, bot lane inhibitor down is the best inhibitor to have down when you're potentially looking at Baron. Baron is going to be alive here just under 2 minutes. Lion knows this. They can continue applying pressure, keeping their opponents back, making them blind to the map, setting up wards in the meantime.
And you'd want to say one saving grace perhaps in how quickly Jax does clear those super waves, and the fact that he still has teleport after the last fight that happened, as it was inside their base. But right now, 1 minute, 20 seconds till the Baron spawns, they send Kira down there to get some free gold, some free experience by himself. I mean, he's only level 15. He's going to have to catch up to the 18 of Seiya, who is miles ahead of him. And so they take their opportunity to use some time to put him into the side wave. But as of right now, it's time for Jax to go down there if they want to keep the supers out.
And we're starting to crest the four items, not including boots, count all across the board for Lion Gaming right now. These guys are getting to the point where the builds are almost done. And they're just frightening. You've got the Warmogs now completed, as well as that Stone Plate over there for Seiya, especially working to make him that much tankier. We've seen the Mercurial Scimitar already be used by White Lotus to cleanse him of those CC effects. Also having the Lord Dominic's Regards means these tanky frontliners on Gambit really aren't that tanky. And Gambit has to execute Nai perfectly to even hope to win one of these fights.
And this is one of those moments where you have to look at the Jhin and just really ask why. You can see what Jhin does for a team, but when you've got a team composition that's set up for a hyper carry, you're not really possessing enough damage right now, and they haven't been able to use it at all. So Jhin not having the impact that was needed for a Gambit AD carry, whereas Lion's AD carry, White Lotus, has been going off.
I mean, we've seen a couple curtain calls open up, and it seems like they accomplish practically nothing as they're just absorbed by the front line. Diamond Prox walking a little bit too close to that brush, and he has no escape mechanisms left. Might be trying to use the ulti to escape. Does do so for now. Walking away with the stone plate, but White Lotus unstoppable with the damage. Edward now going to be stunned up even through the Alistar ultimate.
Oh,
he's
diving.
Still going to drop. In comes Seiya. The dunk into the ground. The double kill for White Lotus. The taunt comes through onto Kira. The triple for White Lotus looking to make it even more. He's got the Quadra.
Oh,
they're gonna give it over! The Pentakill for White Lotus!
Big Pentakill, and the whole game goes towards Lion. They're gonna be able to kill the Nexus as they'd like right now. Big performance from the AD carry.
Pentakill, Penta emote, Lion Gaming, what a show! 35 minutes in, they take down Gambit Esports.
They even got that emote, Captain Flowers. I'll give you that one. It was a fantastic showing from the team. A bit slower than you're used to seeing, perhaps, and maybe that mid-game jitters is something we'll have to readdress as it continues for them throughout the play-ins tournament. But so far, and right now, it's only time to celebrate with a victory like that.
Gambit kept things close at the start. They looked better than they did on day number one, but then Lion found their opportunity to really show off why they are a contender here in the play-in stage, and they looked good doing it. You don't make much more of a climactic finale than what they found at the end of this game.
Absolutely right. And I mean, the hero's entrance from Seiya is the best way to describe it. The fact that Jarrell was aware there was a pentakill going on in the middle of killing an AD carry as Camille, didn't have the bloodlust, made sure he was going to get it all right. It was a team effort here from the Manticore, as you called them,
Manticore.
As they took down the Hydra.
And Seiya's ultimates, I brought it up during the game, and I want to bring it up again now. Just time and time again, always being where he needed to be in both side lanes. The hero's entrances, saving his teammates, applying the pressure so they could find the outplays in what otherwise looked like good moves for Gambit. And for an aggressive team like Gambit that gets baited into wanting to make those plays, the Galio counters were beautiful.
Yeah, to me, that's the biggest difference as well, right? Is the Galio was everywhere. Kira wasn't everywhere. Quite simply, yes, there was a champion difference. There was no teleport on the mid laner, but Seiya was making an impact while he was going everywhere. And if that impact wasn't had, perhaps Kira was able to do something and, you know, get fed, get some experience himself, but not the case.
No, there was almost no point in this game where you were looking at Kira and seeing him as having the same type of an impact on the game that Seiya was, exactly like you said. Seiya utilized his champion in the way it needed to be utilized to carry the game. Kira was not able to find the same success. But to get their thoughts on exactly how that win played out, we're going to send it over to Dracos and the boys.
Anne Froskeren.
I see how it is. He's Captain Flowers and I'm Admiral.
You're one of the boys. It's not a gender term. It's like a...
How dare you assume my flower.
It's an inclusion thing. All right. Anyway, this game, immediately the thing that stood out to me, we saw once again Jax versus Camille, the same matchup that we saw the first time these two teams went together, now on the opposite end.
Yeah, and I'm surprised it kind of played out the way it did because there was a lot of attention around the top lane, but it didn't feel like the advantages ever stuck. Like, one person would get ahead, and then instantly they would lose that advantage. The next person gets ahead, they would lose that advantage. So it was very back and forth, and it was not as clean as you would have thought it should be.
Yeah, and I know we're, like, focusing really hard on the top lane, but also just want to take a step back and just look at the kind of the rest of those compositions. To me, this was such a bizarre, very weird game. It started in the draft phase. It moved over into execution. I understand that Blast is, you know, a very strong Jhin player. It's not a terrible pick into the Kalista matchup, but like you already saw a bunch of tanks. You already saw the Braum, you already saw the Jarvan. The Jhin gets locked in and they just throw on another tank for added measure. They've already got the Jarvan. It's probably going to be the Galio. When is Jhin ever going to have kill pressure on anyone?
Yeah, it's super bad in the context of all the tanks that end up getting locked in. And then it's very immobile. It can get dove very easily. So Kalista, Braum, J4, Galio should at some point dive bot lane.
Oh,
at
but no,
some
sir.
Point.
But no. There's a reason we brought up top lane first. As we look at this first set of replays, you can see that at the end of the day, whatever could have happened bot lane didn't happen because everything was about the top side of the map.
And Jarl showing that he understands these matchups very well because he doesn't just take a lot of these 1v1s. He's often waiting for backup to come in, so he knows that at the same time, Sia will be roaming up here to help get that finishing blow in. That's not to say that he didn't lose his advantages. Stayhouse answering right back.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It was a team effort for Lion to really just blitz up into the top lane and set up Jarl for success because PvP Stayhouse was outplaying the Camille a lot of the time, you know, dodging inside of the heal, looking for the tower dives like right there. But it was just very quick, back and forth. But this was the one that really broke it open for me. Now the 3v2 is Galio will get involved in the back half.
And the reason this is such a poorly timed play for Jarl here is because, or excuse me, for PvP Stayhouse, because he had about a 60 CS lead. They have the later game scaling carries. They're in the perfect position to actually slow this game down and stop letting people die. You don't even need to be going for kills anymore. You have the advantage. But with that double kill going over to the Camille and then an ability to start outplaying Stayhouse now once he gets that extra influx of gold, Jarl is actually going to be able to take this game over.
And that's the thing, he was 60 CS up, and then suddenly Camille had 5 kills, and you basically fed away any sort of advantage that you would build up in your farm.
And the thing is when we look across the board, right, from this point on, it was no longer just about the top lane. Once that was 1v1 was so cleanly decided, now other people started to get involved.
Dracos, they had a Kalista and a Braum, and on the other side you had Jhin and Alistar. We're like, they should just play bottom. Well, there were teleport mismatches.
You're looking too much at analysis, not enough at the Pride 1v1.
He got a pentakill. What more do you need? That's not an analysis. That was bloodshed. He could have had it the entire time.
I mean, the thing is, too, like, top carry versus carry matchup, I understand it, but there's other things to do. You can go to that White Lotus guy. He's pretty good.
Yeah, the White Lotus guy is good. Speaking of pentakill, this is going to be it. This replay brought to you by Acer Predator. Can't imagine a more powerful way to end a series. White Lotus didn't get to play League of Legends for the first 20 minutes, but man, for the last 10, he sure looked like a champion.
Was really enjoying playing Farmville in the bottom lane there. But it just goes to speak to the strength of Lion Gaming, not only in the mechanical ability of White Lotus. We know that this guy is a great AD carry, and he just puts the cherry on top with the pentakill, but then Lion also showing this game that it's not always just about White Lotus, that they can get those great performances from the top lane as well.
And of course, courtesy of that pentakill from White Lotus, yet another stack has been added on top of bonus mystery gifting. That means triple bonus, 2 of 4 potential stacks. So if you are a fan of esports skin or legendary skins, now is the time to get involved.
You should be a fan of Lion Gaming. Both of these increases, the stacks are coming from their games. These guys who are contributing to the entire world. This should be everyone's favorite team.
Well, now, of course, they've locked in a place in the bracket stage as well, comfortably in that second seed position at this point. And it looks good for them right now, right? They, I think, are, from what we've seen of second seed teams or teams that are likely to get second seeds, Lion Gaming are definitely the strongest.
Yeah, they had a pretty competitive game against WE again here. Sure, they came up short in that rematch, and then here they beat Gambit. So I think if you're looking at who people are potentially scared of getting, this is probably the team you're looking out for.
Yeah, and likewise, C&D, we haven't really seen the footage from them, but Lion Gaming was the big surprise of this tournament. We were looking at Gambit Esports. We thought that they were kind of going to be the stylistic favorites here, but Lion just came blitzing through it. Now, you know, Fnatic, HKA, they need to stand strong.
Absolutely is the case. Well, to hear more about the newest team to promote into the play-in stage, let's send it over to Fish and Lions Gaming's jungler. Ooh.
Thanks, guys. I'm here with Oddy, jungler from Lion Gaming, after an impressive victory against Gambit. You went up against Diamond Prox and a great early game performance against him. How did you prepare going up against him?
Ya sabíamos que Diamond Prox es un jugador muy que le gusta abusar del level 1. Así que tuvimos mucho tiempo hablando de cómo podíamos contrarrestarlo, digamos. Y por dicha sacó un jungla tanque que es muy fácil de invadir a los primeros niveles. Y eso fue lo que hicimos. Porque Diamond Prox creo que es un jugador solamente de que early y luego ya desaparece el juego. Así que fue nuestro plan. Esperamos que no hubiera sacado un jungla agresivo, pero lo sacó un jungla tanque, así que pudimos abusar de él.
We know that this guy plays likes to abuse the level 1, so we think a strategy about to counter-attack him. He chose a tank jungler, so it helped him a lot to actually go and push him and make him. And they know that after the first level, actually the jungler doesn't do much, so that was their main goal, to actually neutralize him.
Well, it worked out well for you. Even though you got a kill against you, you're still really strong in the early game, set your team up for success. With that win, you've now secured a spot moving into the next stage of play-ins. And with your impressive performance against teams like Team WE, are you confident going into the next stage of play-ins?
Nosotros sí estamos muy confiados de que podamos salir de grupos, ya que no importa con qué equipo nos toque. La verdad, estoy muy orgulloso de cómo hemos mejorado las últimas semanas y estamos muy confiados de que podemos salir y ganar.
Oh yeah, definitely. We really think that we can actually make to the next stage, to the group stage. He is impressed and so proud how the team has been improved the last couple of weeks, and he is totally confident that he will make it to the groups.
That's fantastic to hear. I hope you guys do make it into the group stage. Excited to see that. The last thing I want to ask you all, let you have the floor, so to speak. Do you have anything you want to say to your fans back at home and everyone that's watching right now?
Un saludo a mi familia, que siempre me apoya, mi papá más que nada, que siempre se queda hasta la noche viéndome y mandándome mensajes. Mi mamá también, mi novia, y pues a todos los fans que la verdad nos siguen apoyando, aunque hubiéramos perdido contra el equipo chino, pero... En serio, muchísimas gracias.
I want to especially thank my family, my father, that he always looked my games, my mother, my girlfriend, and also I want to thank all the fans that keep supporting us, even though we lost against the local team. We want to thank everybody and thank the fans.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Oddy. For now, though, we're going to go into a very quick break, but we'll be back with the rematch between Oceania and Brazil. Direwolves take on Team One next.
No longer has his flash available. Stayos trying to jump in there, might be able to find the first blood, and it goes over to Diamond. Jarral with more health, more mana.
To this.
Might be able to win this fight. Issues the Hextech ultimatum, the Galio coming in, and it might just be an outplay. Nope! Trying to keep him here long enough for Diamond Prox to show up and
diving.
Make this gank happen. Diamond wanting to get in there. Nice cast! Diamond Prox finding himself in a spot where he's almost not able to escape. Flash into the taunt, is able to lock them both down, and Stayos flashing over the wall, barely staying alive until double kill comes in from Jarral. Jarral still barely going to be kept alive by the Camille passive. Genthix walking away from the turret. So much damage. The double kill for White Lotus. The taunt comes through onto Kira. The triple for White Lotus looking to make it even more. He's got the quadra.
Oh, they're going to
give it over. The pentakill for White Lotus.